main questions I have, though, is about the graphics. So you made it so that you can quickly swap between the graphics. How difficult was that to get implemented? And like, why don't you just tell me a little bit more about the process of designing in that way?
Yeah, I mean, the big thing was really about, we wanted to make sure that the game was authentic to the original. And so this is a remaster, not a remake. And the way that we did the remaster was, underneath the surface, the actual engine that's driving the game is the original game. That 2D sprite game that you know and love is under there making all the, did you hit the monster, what loot should fall, all those sorts of things. And so what we've done is we've created a layer on top, and which is this 4K HD layer with Dolby surround sound and those sorts of things. And so, you know, in some ways it was hard to have that, but in another way, because the game is underneath the surface, switching between our HD layer and the game that's running underneath was actually relatively straightforward.
And the big reveal today is that we have a date, September 23rd. The game's going to have cross progression. There's a beta in August on PlayStation, Xbox, PC, where you're adding the Druid and Paladin for the first time. How do I get in as soon as humanly possible to play more Diablo 2?
Well, there's two ways to get in. As part of our announce, for the date, we're also starting pre-orders on console. And so anybody who's pre-ordered on PC and console have the opportunity to get into the early access beta in August. And then after that will be an open beta. So if you want to get in as early as possible, all you have to do is pre-order.
You know, I love taking a look at the technology, especially on the consoles. You have, we're in this time where you got the PS5, the Xbox Series X, the Xbox Series S, and then all the consoles that came before that. So what are your targets on the older consoles, we'll call them, and then the new consoles? Can you tell us more about the tech specs there?
Yeah, I mean, I don't have them all like written out here exactly, but like our goal is on the latest and greatest is to get to that 4K, and trying to push to 60 frames and those sorts of things. I think what's interesting with the technology is just like how much is actually there. Like the fact that you have 8-player co-op, you know, that was something that hasn't been around in a while. And so bringing from, you know, the fact that a feature that existed 21 years ago is actually going to be somewhat new and interesting in 21 years later is kind of fun. But you've got 8 necromancers creating, you know, lots and lots of skeletons. It can definitely push the system. So, yeah, but we're really focused on making sure that it's the best. Like the original was 800 by 600 2D. And like I said, we're really trying to push to this 4K 60 that we can have on and sort of the top of the line consoles and PC.
So like when you're developing and testing this on consoles, you're testing it on PC. How does having those two engines running at the same time, the old one, which is your base, as you said, and the new one that you can swap to on the fly at any time, how do you test that and make sure that both are working well at the same time?
Yeah, it's been great in the sense that we're, you know, because we're so focused on parity, you know, that again, trying to be as authentic as possible, that we can kind of just keep flipping back and forth and understanding, okay, how do we think about, you know, are the things in the right place? And oh, I'm running some weird collision in HD that, oh, when I switch to SD, I can see there's something in the way and we don't have that represented correctly. And you do have to do that testing because, you know, the original game ran on a much lower frame rate. And so where like modern games run on time and sort of the 20 years ago, you were running on frames, you can't do that anymore because you can get the frame count so high, it causes the simulation to sort of break. And so you have to kind of work between this sort of translation layer between something that's running on, you know, a certain number of frames a second versus, okay, how do I run on time so that the events click at the right place? And so it's been a lot of engineering around knowing if you hit, knowing if this animation played at the right time, whether, you know, certain things miss and that, all those sorts of things. So there's been a lot of work to go through that translation of going, okay, a frame-based engine and now a time-based rendering engine for the HD. There's been a lot of complexities to that, but it's working really well. And it feels great both on PC and on console and being able to play with the controller.
Yeah, so you brought up being able to have these big collaborative battles, so to speak, where you just kind of go through and clear the map with a bunch of your friends. What has that been like during playtesting? Like, what has the reaction been that you've seen from the community or just from people playing the game internally at the studio?
Yeah, for the multiplayer stuff, we've only been able to test it so far, you know, within the team and such. Like the alpha we did earlier was a single player alpha, and the response to that was fantastic. And in fact, it was kind of really what allowed us to have confidence in our date because, you know, when you're bringing sort of this beloved game and making it feel modern and contemporary, you're making decisions around what should you leave the same for authentic reasons and what should you change because you want it to be contemporary. Like, hey, maybe if we had a shared stash where you could share equipment across characters, which didn't exist, or having auto gold pickup so that you don't have to click on every piece of gold. You know, those are decisions that we as a team are making, hoping like, okay, let's not mess it up. Like, you have this amazing experience, and that's the joy of doing a remaster. You know, it's fun. You know, it's an amazing game. So don't screw it up as you try to modernize it and make it feel contemporary with the, you know, modern visuals. And so it was really trying to find that balance. And so what the alpha showed us in terms of the feedback that we received from players is that, like, for the most part, we nailed it. Like, we found a really good groove on what we wanted to accomplish with that game. And so that really gave us the confidence to be like, okay, that, you know, now we can focus on, you know, understanding that feedback and reacting to it, but also, like, let's go to the next stage in terms of giving people that multiplayer experience as well. And so that allowed us to feel confident about where we are and why we have the September 23 date.
So was that idea of keeping the original feel, so to speak, was that something you landed on from the get-go? Like, when you were in initial concepting and planning and everything, were you just like, we have to keep it as close to the original as possible with these really minor improvements?
Yeah, that was the big thing. Like, it's Diablo 2 sort of set a bar and kind of helped establish what is the action role-playing genre, right? And so you don't want to mess with that. And that's even when we looked at the balancing, people were saying like, hey, if you're going to remaster the game, why don't you change the balancing of the classes or the balances of the skills? And it was just, it felt like we have to be careful because then it's not that same experience. And so again, like, everything we did, we sort of did with in a measured way of like, okay, are we fundamentally changing how the game plays or how it feels? And versus, are we making sort of your experience better without doing that? And so again, as we made individual choices, like take one of the things about a game like from 21 years ago is that there's a lot more discovery, you know, and a lot more things that weren't explained to you. And so when you get a quest in Diablo 2, you got to go find it. Like, you got to, okay, it says go to the monastery, and you're like, I don't even know where the monastery is, so I'm going to go out and start adventuring and start moving through the maps until I discover the monastery. Whereas a modern game would put a little arrow on your map and say, go here, that's the monastery. And, you know, and that felt like, sure, that's a convenience and a quality of life improvement for some players, but it kind of takes away the essence. And same thing with sort of inventory Tetris. You know, the inventory space in D2 is very small, and people are like, oh, you know, like, what about a charm bag so we can put all of our charms somewhere else? And what if we may increase the inventory size and all these sorts of things? And what you realize is that actually that constraint around your tiny inventory is a big part of what makes the game work in terms of some of the things you have to think about what you're picking up and what you're not. And that Tetris is kind of a big part of the experience of playing. And, you know, for a while we had an auto sort button, and as soon as it went in, you immediately realize that, no, that doesn't work at all. And it takes away some part of what's core to playing the game.
Yeah.
I just want to call out one of the big things about, we're really excited about with the trailer that we were able to show at E3, was really getting to see the cinematic, or a sneak peek at what the cinematics are. So, you know, one of the things we talked about is the game is a remaster. And we felt like the game, you know, again, it's a legendary game. We wanted to make sure that the storytelling and the cinematic quality matched kind of the game. It deserved more than a 4K up res or an AI up res of 20-year-old cinematics. And so we went in and we partnered with our story and franchise development team. They call SFD at Blizzard. They're responsible for all those amazing CG cinematics. And we partnered with a company called Access Entertainment. And we worked together to take the story shot for shot when we make all the cinematics. So 27 minutes of amazing CG cinematics where you get to see sort of Marius's journey and following the Dark Wanderer. And you got to see a little taste of that at E3, and we can't wait to show more.
So, Rod, your career, you've worked on some, you know, major franchises. What has it been like for you jumping into the Diablo franchise? Are there any techniques across the different games you're working on, like Diablo 2, that are being utilized in Diablo 4? Really, I'm fishing for anything about Diablo 4 that you could tease, but yeah, feel free to elaborate on that.
It's a good bridge. I'm glad it was nice of you to tell me what you're going for there. Two things. I mean, one is like from a sort of going from leading, you know, the Gears of War franchise to now leading the Diablo franchise, it's definitely been different in a couple ways. One is, you know, when I was part of Gears, I joined Epic in 2005, and I was part of really Gears from the very beginning. I pretty much had a hand in shipping all versions of Gears, and at some point I kind of became, you know, I was the creative director up at the Coalition as well as the studio head, and I knew, like, when you had a question about Gears of War, you come to me and I can tell you the answer. I knew the lore, I helped create the lore, and those sorts of things. Coming into Diablo, which is one of my favorite franchises ever, and it's been around for 25 years. Like this December will be the 25th anniversary for D1. And even though I was an avid player and I loved it, like I'm still not, like I don't have the depth of knowledge that a creator would have. And so I've really had to come in as a student and not as a teacher in that way. And then the other is really just sort of the pandemic. I mean, made the decision to like, you know, move from Vancouver and start a whole new journey with my family and work on a new franchise. And I had 8 days in the office before the pandemic really hit and we started work from home. And so for the last 15 months that I've been the executive producer for the franchise, I've been doing it through calls like this. And so trying to lead a team and multiple teams, because we've got, you know, Diablo 3 and Diablo 2R, we've got Diablo Immortal and Diablo 4, like helping to guide those teams and work with them. It's been really interesting to have to do through, through a video camera and a monitor. But to go to your fishing for D4 information, I mean, the thing I can say is, you know, one of the things we did after we announced D4 is we really wanted to keep all the players invested in the game and understanding the kind of decisions we were making and include them on the journey. And so we were doing quarterly blog updates and even we did sort of a video blog update at BlizzCon, if you will. So our next one is coming. So it's coming at the end of June and it'll really be focused around the characters and the character art. So we're really excited about having another blog update and keeping people up to date with what we're doing with D4.
Wow. Well, that's great to hear. I'm happy that I got a little bit of something about Diablo 4.
You'll see more, and I promise.
Great, great. And I am truly, really excited about Diablo 2. Thank you. And thank you to the team for all the work that you put in on that game.
Grace once lost. The Golden Order is broken to its core.
The Elden Ring, emboldened by the flame of ambition. Someone must extinguish thy flame.
They will fight, and they will die. In an unending curse.
Thee, I am so proud of you. Do you know what a birthright is, Peter? Something that's a part of you. Like your name.
Gardeners of the Galaxy?
What? No, Rocket. So I let Groot fill out the paperwork. So we got fined.
We appear to be 6,963 units short.
I know, we clearly need a plan.
If you see anything with claws the size of rats, let me know.
We got this.
Drax, roll.
No!
You want monster? I'll show you monster!
No! We disrobe!
Keep your pants on.
Although, it could be used as a distraction.
Smash him up, Drax!
Meet your maker!
We're all professionals here, right? Maybe we can work something out.
Peter!
You had one job, Quill.
I did exactly what?
Gamora, no killing teammates!
That's who?
It's literally in your contract!
I made no such commitments.
In less than 3 cycles, all would be lost. The galaxy cannot be saved, Peter Quill.
We can do this together!
Fucking great, Quill!
These things, where do they come from?
From all of us. From what we do to him.
Can you stop it?
I don't know. But he's my brother. And I would die for him.
Play it day one with Xbox Game Pass.
You have shown an aptitude for applying lethal solutions to conflicted situations. We wish to test your abilities.
Thank you.
stories, memorable characters, and vibrant gameplay are in store as you lead the commanding officers to victory. Play the first two Advance Wars campaigns in Advance Wars 1 Plus 2 Reboot Camp, marching on to Nintendo Switch this holiday. Pre-orders begin today on Nintendo eShop.
What's up, everybody? IGN Executive Editor of Commerce and proud U.S. Air Force Senior Airman Seth Macy here to break down all of the biggest announcements, trailers, and news from IGN's Summer of Gaming. Did you miss something? I got you covered. This is IGN's coverage of the coverage presented by USAA Insurance. USAA serves military members and their families. With their unique understanding of their members' needs, USAA Insurance provides proactive service and exceptional products. As a proud member of USAA for over 20 years, I can safely say USAA Insurance makes it easy to protect the things you care about. But now, let's get to the news. Nintendo kicked off their Direct with yet another Smash fakeout that saw Tekken's Kazuya Mishima drop the incapacitated bodies of other Smash fighters into a volcano. That's right, the angry man from Tekken is joining Super Smash Brothers. For those with a fondness for monkeys trapped inside rolling balls, rejoice! Super Monkey Ball Banana Mania features remakes of Super Monkey Ball, Super Monkey Ball 2, and Super Monkey Ball Deluxe, and it releases this October 5th. One of the Direct's biggest surprises was the announcement of Metroid Dread. This is a title that was originally in development for the Nintendo DS and was long thought canceled. But hey, it's back. It's coming to Nintendo Switch October 8th of this year. The trailer shows off fancy new armor for Samus, a new nemesis that will stalk her around and be very scary. So like think Boston Dynamics dog crossed with GLaDOS from Portal, but more agile. The announcement also came with the acknowledgement that yes, Metroid Prime 4 is still in development. Speaking of surprises, everyone's favorite nasty man is back with a collection of new games. WarioWare Get It Together features two-player co-op and Wario speaking in full sentences. Unsettling to say the least. After that, they resurrected the GBA classic Advance Wars with Advance Wars 1 and 2 Reboot Camp. It's a Switch collection of the first two games with entirely new graphics. Nintendo also announced a ton of other things, including Shin Megami Tensei 5, but yo, yeah, let's just get to what everyone is waiting for. Last but not least, it finally happened. We got more Breath of the Wild 2 footage. We saw Link free-falling out of the sky in a new outfit and a new Sheikah arm. That fancy little arm looks like it's replacing the Sheikah slate because we get glimpses of Link using stasis on some spiky boulders. The game's got a whole lot going on, and honestly, I'm probably just gonna rewatch the trailer for like the millionth time as soon as I finish this video. And that does it for today's coverage of the coverage. What did you think of all the announcements? Let us know in the comments below. And remember, USAA makes it easy to cover your rigs and gaming gear. Make sure you've got the right coverage with USAA Insurance. Membership, eligibility, and product restrictions apply and are subject to change. Property and casualty insurance provided by United Services Automobile Association and its affiliate property and casualty insurance companies is available only to persons eligible for PNC Group membership. Each company has sole financial responsibility for its own products.
What's up, everybody? I'm Damon Hatfield. Welcome to a very special live episode of GameScoop here on IGN's Summer of Gaming. E3 may be in the rear view, but the summer continues with our Pride stream this Friday, the EA Play event on July 22nd, and Gamescom in August, plus whatever surprises pop up in between. We'll be covering it all, and you can find our Summer of Gaming coverage pretty much anywhere. At IGN.com, on YouTube, across social media, or even on your smart TV. Without further ado, my guests today are Lucy O'Brien from Podcast Beyond.
Beyond, hello.
Miranda Sanchez from Podcast Unlocked.
Hi, hello, welcome everyone.
And Zach Ryan from Nintendo Voice Chat.
Greetings.
Greetings, everybody. What's up, everybody? First things first, let's talk about Xbox. Now, going into E3, Xbox had a lot to prove. The Series X is here. It's a great console, but looking down the road, we weren't really sure what we were going to be playing on it through the rest of this year and into 2022. Now we know. Xbox showed a lot of games, a lot of exclusives, and a lot coming to Game Pass day one. Miranda, what did you think of the Xbox E3 showcase this year?
Gonna be honest, just a tiny bit disappointed that we didn't get a new Fusion Frenzy announcement, but in all seriousness though, I think they did a fantastic job. The pacing of the showcase was just what they needed. We knew certain things were going to be there. Like, they had to give an update on Halo Infinite, right? Like, that was an obvious expected thing. Bethesda, they were not going to not show Starfield. So those were just things we knew were going to be on the dock. And so for me, I needed Xbox to come out and give that one more thing. That was not those two. Those two games could not close the show because they have still more to prove, right? They've acquired all of these different studios. They have all these exclusives that they're trying to flaunt. But I need to know what's coming like soon and what's happening that we should be excited for. And they really did show that, I think, in this press conference.
Lucy, what did you think while you were watching the show through your PlayStation goggles?
Look, I have an Xbox as well, and I love my Xbox. And I think I agree with Miranda that there was a lot on the table. There was a lot to prove this year. And I think Xbox came out, absolutely, to use a terrible cliche, absolutely swinging. I think that Game Pass, as I said this on last week's episode of Next Gen Console Watch, I think Game Pass is making the Xbox an unmissable sort of infrastructure right now. I think everything that we saw at this show, and so many of them coming to Game Pass day one, was really impressive. You know, it's kind of up to Sony to step up its game right now. Frankly, I was just really impressed, and I'm pleased also that Xbox is really focusing on exclusives as well. I say that with my heart in my shoes, because no Starfield for PlayStation players. But, you know, Xbox has needed exclusives for a while, and now they've got them.
It is true. Sony has been pretty quiet in the midst of all these announcements. We'll talk a little bit about what we expect to see from Sony next a little bit later in the show. Everyone seems to agree that Microsoft had a good showing this year. Zach, do you count yourself among that camp?
Yeah, we always talk every year, everybody does, about who won E3. Which presentation, you know, ended up at the top of the list. And I honestly think it was Xbox this year. I think Microsoft's presentation was phenomenal. I think they showed off a lot of new stuff. I think they gave pertinent updates on a lot of stuff that we knew was coming. And like Lucy said, not to belabor the fact, but Game Pass is by far and away the best deal in gaming right now. If you are a casual gamer and you want to pick up an Xbox Series S and Game Pass, I mean, hundreds of games at your fingertips. Like it's such a good deal. And I think leaning into that, especially having all their new stuff day one on Game Pass, is such a smart call. I think Xbox really blew me away this year.
Let's dive into Halo Infinite with a little bit more depth. Halo Infinite was supposed to be out in the wild for over 6 months now. It was supposed to be a launch game with the Series X, of course. It had a big campaign reveal last summer that received mixed reception. Following that, it was delayed into the fall of 2022. But I think, Miranda, I think everyone seems, at least the Halo fans, seem really happy with what they saw in the showcase, especially from the multiplayer. I'd be curious to hear your thoughts, as me as a more casual player, someone who probably would only play the campaign. I was a little disappointed that we didn't get an updated look at the campaign. But what were your thoughts?
As a big Halo fan, I regularly play through that series, replay those games. I think I've only played Halo at least like the first one, at least 4 or 5 times all the way through, not if more, probably more. Anyway, but as far as the reveal goes, I think focusing on multiplayer made a lot of sense because we have a sense of what we're going to get with the campaign in terms of Master Chief's next story. And I could see them maybe saying, like, okay, we have a limited time for this press conference. What are we going to show? We will do a small reel for the multiplayer, or like a small reel, excuse me, a longer reel for the multiplayer, which is what we haven't shown yet, and then a quick segment for the campaign, which is what we're seeing right now. And I think that gave us enough context for the story of like, oh, well, what happened with Cortana? Like, what's going on next in the story? And just kind of like updating what we already know and adding more information without giving us too much. I do hope that they have even some extra event between now and fall just to kind of revisit the campaign and really show off like, hey, here's all the improvements we've been making. I think it was smart of them to just, again, focus on the new thing. Like, let's talk about multiplayer. It's going to be free to play. It's a big deal that you can just download it. You don't have to buy Halo. It doesn't matter if you have Game Pass. Just download multiplayer. Yeah. It's going to be cool. And honestly, I am so glad that they also took time to do an extra multiplayer, like kind of dev walkthrough video after the fact as well. And this kind of goes to, back to my earlier point about Microsoft just doing such a great job of pacing their show. Like, of course, someone like me, I want all the details about multiplayer. I want to know everything. However, like Dane and people like you maybe don't necessarily need the deep dive. And that kind of slows down the conference, right? And so I think they just did a stellar job of making sure they gave just enough information, for, especially for those people who were more interested in something, while not holding up the rest of the show. So I was really pleased with what they showed, especially, again, after the fact. But I, like you, would also like more information on the campaign because I'm excited about it. So,
Well, Lucy, of course, Sony has no shortage of exclusive games, but Halo represents something Sony doesn't really have, which is just, you know, a AAA caliber first-person shooter. Is the Halo series something that you follow? And what did you think of what you saw at the showcase this year?
I mean, I will say that I thought it was really impressive. Halo is a blind spot for me. I'll be completely honest. Like, I never really played Halo, so I can only speak to the sort of general fan reaction that I saw from this multiplayer reveal, which to me looked really impressive. But people seem really stoked. And again, you know, I just want to echo everything that Miranda said. Like, it was just the perfect amount of a teaser. Like, we got a lot of new information from that teaser, but it did not belabor the point. It did not outstay its welcome. And again, it really seems like that extra time has been absolutely worth it. So, you know, the conversation has gone from Halo Infinite is in a really troubled place to Halo Infinite is looking really, really cool.
Do you agree, Zach? Would you consider yourself excited for Halo Infinite?
Yeah, similarly to Lucy, you know, Series X is my first Xbox that I've owned outright. I've completely missed the entire Halo series. And honestly, the more I see of Halo Infinite, the more I'm like, I need to go back and play through these games. I have the Master Chief Collection. It is on Game Pass. Like, I do feel inspired to go through and get a taste of what everybody has been so excited about for 2 decades, you know, while I've been playing PlayStation and Nintendo games.
Kind of from that point, too, like, honestly, it makes me sad that, like, I'm kind of reverse. My first PlayStation console was a PlayStation 2 that I bought specifically just for Kingdom Hearts. Like, I was a small child, I was like, I want Kingdom Hearts. And I really do wish that Sony would match Microsoft in doing something like Game Pass so I could revisit those old classics like you guys can do with Master Chief. Also, if you guys want to play Halo, let me know. I'll walk you through it.
Please be, right, be our guide, Miranda. We need it.
Happily.
Miranda will carry you. One of the biggest net announcements out of all of E3 was Starfield. We got a release date, confirmation that it is definitely an Xbox console exclusive. Miranda, we know now it's basically Skyrim in space. That tells me all that I need to know. Were you surprised to finally have confirmation that it is definitely an Xbox exclusive?
No, I was absolutely not surprised. It just made sense. Like, you don't spend all that money for it to not be exclusive. Like, that doesn't make sense. So, I think that they're going to be like, I think Microsoft has done a good job so far as like maintaining games that have been released on other platforms that they acquired later, like especially with Mojang and Minecraft. Like, that's just been a longstanding thing. And they won't like pull things off. However, Starfield never had that, like, here's where everything's going to be. And I guess if also you really don't want to buy an Xbox for whatever reason, like, you still have the PC option. Like, that's going to be another thing. So, you know, it just made sense to me.
Yeah. Is Starfield something that you're excited for?
Yeah, absolutely. I love the approach that they had with the design here. I think it gives like I know they're trying to hit more of a realistic look at space, and it looks more near future than it does like, say, mm-hmm. Mass Effect, right? Where it's just so intensely sci-fi that it's unreachable. Yeah. But this looks like something's like, oh, well, this could be a future. And I kind of like how, in a way, Fallout feels like that, even though obviously not. But, it just feels grounded in a very specific way, but with just touches of fantasy that make it, I think, just the perfect amount of fun. So it seems like Starfield's aiming for that as well. And mm-hmm. I like that sandwich as much as everyone else did, I think, too. So,
well, the Xbox cool exclusivity might be frustrating, especially for some PlayStation owners. And in fact, Bethesda's Pete Hines ended up issuing some sort of an apology, acknowledging at least that frustration. Lucy, would you say you feel that frustration? I know you said you own an Xbox Series X, but...
Yeah, I mean, obviously, you know, I want people who just own a PlayStation 5 to get as many games as they feasibly can. That console is not cheap. And it's also a wonderful console. But, you know, I'm also not surprised. This is a smart business. It's a bummer. But it's smart on the Xbox side of things. I don't feel like Pete was, you know, apologizing for the exclusiveness. I feel like he's always been a kind of more approachable, you know, they call him Uncle Pete, right? Like, he's an approachable kind of dude. And I sort of get what he was going for in that interview. He was just like, I'm sorry, this sucks. You know, well, it's not, it was not an apology for the deal. It was just like, I recognize that this sucks.
Yeah.
He clarified that statement on Twitter too. He went out and said like, hey, I was apologizing for people's frustrations, not that we're exclusive to Xbox, because obviously they're beholden to Microsoft at this point. Like, you know, like it's totally Microsoft's decision where they're allowed to publish those games. And so, yeah, I think it's not surprising that this is an exclusive. And I think that his apology was, you know, it totally made sense to me. Like, yeah, it is frustrating for games to be exclusive when they've previously been, you know, a multi-platform developer and publisher.
And I appreciated his candidness, right? Like, mm-hmm. it's kind of rare that you see that in communications departments. And like, I'm unsurprised that it made headlines, but like, mm-hmm. I appreciated it. Mm-hmm.
So Skyrim in space, Zach, does that sound like something you want to play?
Well, I love Skyrim and I love space. So yeah, I'm into that. And I, you know, like Miranda said, I love the retro, or not the retro future, but like this near future feel. It seems to me like this story is kind of going to maybe be something about humanity looking for the next, you know, like era, the next place to go. And like, that is also something that I'm very interested in exploring. And I just think Bethesda makes really great games. And, you know, I'm excited to check this one out.
Yeah. And apparently this trailer is all running in engine too, so that's it nuts. Should give us a pretty good hint at what the game is actually going to look like, which is very exciting. But now, Microsoft's one more thing at the end of the conference was, surprisingly enough, something new from Arkane, Dishonored developers, and a studio that already has Deathloop coming up very soon. The one more thing was Redfall, and Miranda, I think you're very excited about this one, is that right?
Ecstatic. Oh my goodness. Guys, this is just... I love Arkane. I love Dishonored. It's one of my favorite game series just ever. I think Prey was fantastic. I love their stories and just how they design their games. I'm like a big Bioshock fan. And like, basically, if you have a gun in one hand, powers in the other, it's first person, I'm here for it. And Arkane just does such a fantastic job with those kinds of games. And seeing this, oh man, like, obviously we didn't actually get to see any gameplay, and I think there's a lot of speculation of like, what is this? Is it a looter shooter? Is it like Destiny? It's like, guys, this is Arkane, it's not gonna be that. Which they did later confirm on their website for Redfall, that sort of announced that this is going to be an open world first person shooter. You have the option for multiplayer, and you get to play as one of the characters they have since announced. I have a hunch that they're probably gonna announce more characters based on like some of the wording and phrasing of like how they've positioned who you get to play as, and you're fighting vampires and there's like magic, and it's fantastic. The tone of this trailer was so fun too, and I think with vampires, like, you always rock a weird line, right? Like, are you gonna go for that super gothic horror, are you like rocking the sexy vampire who's just like super powerful, but also just looks like a normal human? I liken this one. You get these vampires and they're just intimidating as heck. And they're so monstrous, but also really cool. And so they just nailed so many aspects of this reveal for me. And again, like having been a big fan of Arcane games, I kind of know what to expect as far as like what the gameplay is. Like, I know that's going to be solid. So I'm really excited. I'm letting myself be super excited.
Yeah, I think that it's also of note to point out that, you know, this is Xbox's one more thing. Like, you know, historically, that's the biggest and, you know, brightest reveals come at the end of the show. And I just think it's awesome to live in an era where that's an Arcane game. You know, Arcane, we talked about it a little bit in our setup before we got started here, but Arcane has always been a critical darling, but not necessarily like a smashing commercial success. And I just think it's awesome that Xbox, Microsoft gave them the limelight at the end of their presentation and said, here's something that we're really proud of and really looking forward to, and you should be excited as well.
Yeah, it's interesting to think about how long Redfall has been in development, and could it have been something that caught Microsoft's eye and helped convince them to make the purchase of Bethesda? Lucy, I think you're also a big Arcane fan. I think you were saying before we started this live stream that you thought Dishonored 2 was one of the best games ever made. So are you excited for Redfall?
I did. I still believe that. I reviewed Dishonored 2 for IGN back in the day. I gave it a 9.3 when we still had that kind of a scale. On reflection, could have probably these days given it a 10. But look, I sort of want to echo what Zach said. I have been always a little bit worried about Arcane because like their games haven't necessarily been commercial successes. And I think that this is one of the best things to come out of this Bethesda acquisition is that Arcane is finally getting put into the spotlight that they deserve. They're one of the most clever, forward-thinking, lateral-thinking, bizarre developers working today. And I'm just so excited that finally more people are paying attention to them because, you know, as Zach said, it's the one big thing at the end of the Xbox show. It's like, yes, this is the developer to pay attention to. And I think Redfall looks absolutely wonderful.
Yeah, it's really exciting stuff. There were a ton of games shown off during Microsoft conference. A lot more we could talk about, although we're running out of time. We want to make sure we have time to talk about Nintendo and PlayStation and all the third-party stuff. But Psychonauts 2 is just around the corner. A very cool-looking game called Replaced 2.5D. Cinematic platformer was just announced. I know that a lot of people are really excited for that one. But right now, it's time for a quick break. We'll be right back with more GameScoop Live and the latest from Nintendo and Square Enix. Stick around.
IGN's Summer of Gaming is powered by Duracell Optimum. All summer long, we're bringing you the game announcements, developer interviews, and all the demos you care about. So get comfortable and get ready to play. Upgrade your Logitech mouse with Duracell Optimum batteries today.
Not only is IGN the world's biggest media brand for games and entertainment, but we also have a team of some of the world's biggest fans of your favorite franchises. From breaking news and exclusives, never-before-seen looks at movies and games, to reviews, Let's Plays, and live streams, IGN brings you all the coverage you need, no matter where you are. Whether you're on IGN.com, the IGN app, YouTube, Facebook, or Snapchat, we've always got you covered. IGN, the number one source for all games and entertainment fans worldwide.
Everybody loves watching a speedrun of their favorite game, but what if you got a chance to peek into the mind of the developers behind those games as they watch their hard work get completely destroyed right in front of them?
What is happening right now?
That's exactly what happens on every episode of Devs React to Speedruns. We invite you to ride along with the developers as they watch, react, and enjoy some of the craziest gameplay by the most skilled speedrunners on the planet. Tune in every Saturday for a brand new episode.
In a world with nonstop news about Marvel, DC, Star Wars, you need a show with accurate reporting, hard-hitting commentary, and...
Me, Akeem Lewanson, host of IGN's news show, The Fix Entertainment. Whether it's the latest superhero scoop, film fiasco, or anime announcement, I'll be here covering all the breaking movie, TV, and streaming news that matters most to you. Make sure to catch The Fix Entertainment on IGN for your fix of entertainment news. Let's drop it.
Welcome back, everyone. This is GameScoop Live, and I'm your host, Damon Hatfield. Right now, we are talking about the biggest hits out of the Nintendo Direct, and of course, the most epic of them all was the kicker, a teaser for Breath of the Wild Part 2. Zach, what did you think of Nintendo's E3 Direct this year?
I personally loved it. I think it was a pretty dichotomous direct. I think they're you know, I saw a lot of people celebrating what Nintendo showed off, and I saw a lot of people being like, "That's it. That's all you got." I at the risk of sounding a little bit gatekeepy, I think that this was a direct for like hardcore Nintendo fans. They showed a lot of like really great B tier stuff, and then of course Breath of the Wild 2, which everyone is excited for. Me especially. I've got Breath of the Wild going on in the background here, but cool. I thought it was really solid. I loved that they are bringing back a couple of old franchises like WarioWare and Advanced Wars, and then you know new stuff too, like this new Breath of the Wild game. I as a Nintendo fan, it spoke to me, and I was really really into what they were showing off.
That's an interesting observation that it was probably more aimed at hardcore fans, because you're right, big titles like Animal Crossing and Pokemon were missing from this year's Direct. But lots for people like us to enjoy. Miranda, what did you think of the Nintendo E3 Direct?
I felt like they were good announcements, but many of them were maybe not for me. So for instance, here, Advance Wars, I've never played that. Don't really care about it. I know a lot of people really excited about Metroid. Also not really my thing. Though I can appreciate that people were really excited for it. However, I was really happy to see WarioWare. I love WarioWare. I think they're just like the perfect bite-sized mini games. It's such a fun time. And I was happy to see a new Mario Party release with it's like, let's just bring back the classics. It's gonna have multiplayer at launch. It's gonna work, hopefully. there's a way to like save your progress if you're playing online, which that's a big thing for me and my siblings. So it's like, okay, cool. I like that a lot. And then of course, Breath of the Wild. And those are pretty much the three things that were big for me. Breath of the Wild was another one of those, like, we kind of expect it to be shown off, right? Like, it's got to be soon. So there's got to be something. So I was glad to see that as well.
And Lucy, was there enough in the Nintendo Direct to get you excited?
Definitely. I mean, I would call myself a more casual Nintendo fan. But obviously Breath of the Wild 2, you know, Breath of the Wild, I think, is in the top three games of you know, this last generation. Even though the Nintendo Switch has not yet had a successor. I think that the sequel is just so exciting. And, you know, judging from my Twitter, there was something for seemingly everyone in this direct who likes Nintendo.
I mean,
everyone seemed extremely, psyched over games that, as Miranda said, I don't really necessarily care about, but you know, there was a lot of like furious exciting typing as these games were announced, and I think at the end of it, like, it was a really successful show. It wasn't as breathtaking as Xbox's, but I would say that this was definitely the second best conference at E3 this year.
Let's dive a little bit into Breath of the Wild 2. What they showed wasn't a huge amount, but there was enough to tease and get people excited, and definitely enough to start sparking some wild theories about who we're going to be playing as in this game and exactly when it's set. Zach, it's not coming until next year. So how would you gauge your sort of excitement for Breath of the Wild 2 right now?
Breath of the Wild, the original, is my favorite game of all time. I've played it multiple times. I love it so, so much. I think it's damn near a perfect video game. So I honestly, like, Breath of the Wild 2 is at the top of my list for games that I'm most excited about. I am disappointed that it's not coming this year. Longtime NBC listeners will know that I've often predicted that we would get new Switch hardware launching day and date with Breath of the Wild 2 this holiday season. Doesn't look like that's going to happen. And knowing Zelda's history of being delayed, I'm just hoping for an early 2022 release. You know, maybe they'll do a nice 5-year anniversary by, you know, launching Breath of the Wild 2 in the spring. But yeah, I mean, I think that the trailer was really smart. It was very short, you know, it was only a minute and a half. And the last 20 seconds of that trailer is just this shot of the castle floating above Hyrule. But like you said, they showed off new powers. They showed off new enemies. They got enough in there that set the lore dorks like myself ablaze, talking about like, where in the timeline does this fall? Are we playing multiple timelines? Are we playing multiple characters? What do these things mean? Like, I thought it was a really smart trailer for being as short as it was. And yeah, I mean, my hype level for this game continues to remain a 10 out of 10. So.
Do you have your own theories about what's going on?
Yeah, I subscribe to the Barrett Courtney rule of thought for this one. The guys over at Kinda Funny did a very great explainer about potentially playing as Ganondorf in this this next one, and I would love to see something like that. There's obvious ties to Skyward Sword. You know, that I think that Nintendo is reissuing Skyward Sword in July for a reason. Now, Breath of the Wild, the original, had ties to all, you know, references to all of the previous Zelda games, hidden, tucked away, some readily apparent and some, you know, kind of deep cuts. But this one specifically seems to be tied much more closely to Skyward Sword, which is not my favorite Zelda game, but I am interested to see how they tie those two worlds together.
Yeah, I mean, that would make a lot of sense. They have the Skyward Sword HD coming out next month.
Yeah.
Miranda, since you work in guides, does the prospect of a sequel to Breath of the Wild, is that exciting or daunting to you?
Both.
What's that? Oh, both.
Both. Yeah. To be honest, like, I didn't actually work on a Breath of the Wild guide. Like, I only did one page, and that was for fun. And so I was just like, oh, I'm having a good time. Like, I got to play it with my free time. So shout out to Brendan Graber, who did a lot of that guide and slayed it. Like, we seriously have such a beautiful guide for that. And I am looking forward to us having another beautiful guide for Breath of the Wild too. But honestly, I think there's such, or there was at least such a magic for Breath of the Wild, like as part of discovery and finding cool things. And it felt like we kept digging into so many mysteries. But like, did you see this? Did you see that? Did you find this one character who said that thing? And I'm really looking forward to getting that sense again. Mm-hmm. And I'm hoping it will. And I'm sure they will do that as well. So I'm very excited.
Also, Link has sick long hair now,
yeah,
which is awesome.
And a magic arm.
Yeah.
Now, Metroid Dread was a huge surprise. That was a game that IGN was covering in the mid-2000s that I don't think many of us thought would ever see the light of day. But it's real. It's Metroid 5. It's the next game canonically in the Metroid series, apparently concluding Samus's story. But Miranda, you said you're not really a Metroid fan. Or is that because you don't like Metroidvania-style games, or just haven't played the Metroid series?
I like Metroidvania-style games. I just haven't played the Metroid series, and I don't like side-scrolling platformers. I just really haven't connected with them. I didn't really grow up with them. And so when it came to it, like, for example, when I think about the Mario games, my favorite are always the like more 3D adventure Marios. Like Mario 64 was my first Mario game, and that was like, it was that, then Super Mario Sunshine, like that's what I connected with. So I was, I think, a little young to play Metroid when we did have like Nintendo consoles, and just seeing this, I'm like, oh, I'm really happy for everyone who's so excited to finally get to play this game. But looking at it, it's like, that's probably not something I would want to play, but
sure.
That's okay.
Lucy, how about you? Are you a Metroid fan?
I am not, but this looks really cool. I'm not, but just by virtue of I grew up in New Zealand, and Sega was the predominant console, and I had a Mega Drive, and just never really played some of those like iconic Nintendo classics as a result. But, you know, this looks freaking cool. And, you know, I was chatting to a colleague of ours, Kat Bailey, who wrote this video that we're watching right now. And, you know, she said that she will be a guide for me through my first ever Metroid journey. So
nice.
I'm excited to play it for sure. And, you know, just by virtue of Switch being just the most accessible console on the planet, in terms of just being able to, you know, pick it up and play it anywhere, this is definitely going to be my first Metroid.
That's exciting. I think it's very cool that, you know, Nintendo's the only first party platform holder that used their E3 showcase to show off a brand new 2D game in one of their long running beloved franchises. Zach, I think you're probably excited for Metroid Dread.
Damon, the hype levels are off the charts, my man. I've recently come to a realization about myself. Metroidvania is the style of game that I like to play. Like, cool. Outside of Zelda, Metroidvania is probably like the genre that I've spent the most time with. And specifically because of Metroid, I think it is such a criminally underrated franchise. Miranda, Lucy, totally understand your not necessarily avoidance, but like that you just haven't gotten into it. I think a lot of people haven't. And I will say, Metroid slaps. Check it out. Mm-hmm. But this game specifically, like, not only was I so excited to see a 2D Metroid, but when the title card came up and it was revealed as Metroid Dread, I literally like stood up and threw my headphones off. Like, Metroid Dread has been rumored since 2004 or 2005.
Yeah.
There was like some very sneaky references in the Metroid Prime games to Dread. Like, it was Sakamoto said in the Nintendo Treehouse interview that this game was canceled twice. Two times this game was canceled and came back from the grave. So I'm super, super stoked for this. I also think that Metroid has such an incredible like backstory and lore. And this kind of picks up right where Fusion left off and will conclude the series. Just like the Zelda games, the Metroid games were released not in timeline order, not canonical, right? Like, they're, you know, the games jump back and forth all over the timeline. And this one is at the very end of the timeline and will conclude Samus's story with Metroid. And like, man, I couldn't be more excited for this game. I'm so glad that it's coming out in October. I can't believe that they waited until June to announce this, but we've heard multiple rumors that this game has been done for a long time. So like, such a nice move of Nintendo and a smart move to hold this for a time when they're like, okay, we don't have a ton of games, but here's an excellent, potentially excellent callback to a long beloved franchise. So
sure. Yeah,
obviously I'm very excited about Metroid.
But now, Zach, were you surprised that E3 came and went with no announcement of a Switch Pro?
No, they told us they weren't going to talk about it. This is something that I feel like has been a big part of the conversation around E3, and something that developers and publishers have been really more actively participating in is telegraphing, like, hey, here is what our conference is going to be about, or here is what our event is going to be about, because I think they're trying to avoid setting these lofty expectations and then having people get upset or disappointed that those things aren't revealed. And Nintendo came out early and said, hey, we're going to be showing primarily software, and it's going to be primarily software that is dropping in 2021. So don't expect to see anything beyond that. Do I think that the Switch Pro is approaching a release or an announcement? Yes, definitely. I wouldn't be surprised if before the end of the year we see some announcement about a Switch Pro, but I was not surprised that we didn't see it at E3.
Do you think it's out this year, or is it out next year with Breath of the Wild 2?
I've said a lot that it would be day and date with Breath of the Wild 2, but it would probably make more sense to launch it around holiday. So maybe by the end of this year.
Well, there was also another significant Nintendo announcement that came out of Ubisoft, and that was Mario plus Rabbids Sparks of Hope. And I know Miranda is just super excited for that.
Loves a rabbit. Loves a good rabbit.
Don't look at me. Don't talk to me.
The first game is really good. Miranda, before the first Mario plus Rabbids, I agreed with you completely. I would have supported hunting rabbids to extinction. But the game is so good, and they handled the Nintendo properties so well that I've softened on my feelings towards rabbits.
It's just such a shame that they're like, let's do a cool collaboration with Mario, but then they stuck in the rabbits.
But Miranda, I get it. But I felt like, I agree with Damon. Before this, the original game, I thought that rabbits were kind of like minions, just sort of ubiquitous and annoying. But I loved the first game, and what we saw was so cool, and I'm so psyched for a second one. What, I mean, did you not enjoy the first game?
Oh, I didn't play it. There's no way. There's absolutely no way. And, like, the thing is, these games could be one of the best games ever made. I'm not gonna play it. I cannot stand the rabbits. I really can't. And like, I think sometimes you just have to draw a line, okay? They're just look at them. They're so awful to look at. Okay. Anyway, please continue. I know people do love them, and that's fine. I don't. I hate these stories. Oh, gosh. Okay. Anyway, go ahead.
I like the first game a lot. I like the style of game. I'm excited we're getting a sequel. Lucy, another big announcement around Summer of Gaming. Finally, Elden Ring finally fully revealed. How's it looking to you?
This was my announcement of the sort of whole, you know, event season. I think it looks just incredible. I think that the enemy designs, the world building, the fact, you know, the lore that we've already been told through our very, very incredible interview with Miyazaki. He was so giving with his answers. You know, there's so much here to sort of sink our teeth into already. And it's kind of wild, you know, we've gone from a period where the Elden Ring subreddit was just making up their own lore because they had so... they had nothing to go on, and now there's just so much to go on. There's so much information out there about this game already. I love that they're putting an emphasis on freedom. Like there's sort of more ways in which to approach boss battles. You can play more stealthily now. There's a collectible element with you know, being able to summon enemies that you've defeated, and you know, of course there's, you know, co-op returns as well. But just look at this footage. I mean, again, I don't think there is anyone doing character and enemy design better than FromSoft. It was unlike anything else that we saw last week. I was blown away. It was better than I could have hoped. I tweeted out that it sort of looks like the only game I'll ever need. I know I'm being hyperbolic, but I was just, you know, I was so excited for this game and this trailer and the subsequent interview with Miyazaki and the information that he gave us fulfilled every single one of my hopes.
Wow. You're making me excited for you. Zach, do you consider yourself a fan of the Soulsborne games?
Big time, yeah. I played all the Souls games. Some of them multiple times. I couldn't be more excited for this. Shout out to my man Tam from GameSpot for absolutely losing his mind when this was announced. I was glad that we got at least something to look at because he's been just chomping at the bit for this this game for so long, and like many of us. And similarly, outside of Nintendo stuff, this was probably the announcement that got me the most excited because of the radio silence. But man, yeah, I echo everything Lucy said. This game looks sick. I can't wait to play it. I like what they're doing with the spin on the Souls genre as it's typically been. George R. R. Martin was out there saying some weird stuff last week, but that's okay. Well, you know, yeah. That's no big deal. Yeah, I'm stoked for another FromSoft game. I'll play them all. I'm a big fan.
And Miranda, how about you? Are these your kind of games?
Yes, I do enjoy them a ton. I love Dark Souls 1 and 3. I skipped 2, sorry. And Bloodborne is up next to me.
It's the best one.
Excited to get into them. Yeah, Miranda, I'm very excited. I know.
I'm so excited for you to play Bloodborne.
Yes. And so seeing this, it's just, I have to like pace myself, right? Because I know I'm going to adore Bloodborne. I'm just like, this is going to be a good time, I'm saying. I'm just also so relieved for all the people out there who are waiting for anything with Elden Ring. I feel so bad because every time we have an event, we say like, oh, we have something to announce. They're like, oh my God, is it Elden Ring? Do you have Elden Ring? It's like, I'm so sorry. But now we don't have to be sorry because we get cool summoning horses, nice little steed, and Pokemon in Dark Souls. Yeah. Love it.
I'm here for it.
Well, you have until January, I think, to get through Bloodborne when Elden Ring arrives. I would love to keep talking, and we will. Right after a quick break, when Games Group returns, we will be talking about PlayStation and what Sony's got on the horizon.
IGN Summer of Gaming 2021 is presented by the Amazon original movie, The Tomorrow War, exclusively on Prime Video July 2nd, and powered by Duracell Optimum, the official battery sponsor of Summer of Gaming 2021, and presented by USAA Insurance. And Army National Guard. Pursue multiple paths while you serve. Reach your greatest potential with Army National Guard.
Not only is IGN the world's biggest media brand for games and entertainment, but we also have a team of some of the world's biggest fans of your favorite franchises. From breaking news and exclusives, never-before-seen looks at movies and games, to reviews, Let's Plays, and live streams, IGN brings you all the coverage you need, no matter where you are. Whether you're on IGN.com, the IGN app, YouTube, Facebook, or Snapchat, we've always got you covered. IGN, the number one source for all games and entertainment fans worldwide.
In a world with nonstop news about Marvel, DC, Star Wars, you need a show with accurate reporting, hard-hitting commentary, and...
Me, Akeem Lewanson, host of IGN's new show, The Fix Entertainment. Whether it's the latest superhero scoop, film fiasco, or anime announcement, I'll be here covering all the breaking movie, TV, and streaming news that matters most to you. Make sure to catch The Fix Entertainment on IGN for your fix of entertainment news. Let's drop it.
If you're not following IGN on social media, what are you waiting for? We're constantly updating our feeds to bring you the latest news, gameplay, custom original content, the best user-generated videos and art, memes, and a whole lot more. Be part of the conversation throughout the year. Follow IGN on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, TikTok, and Snapchat.
What's up, everyone? Sydney here to bring you a little update about the future of IGN on YouTube. We've been listening to your feedback, and it seems like some of you are more into games, while others are more interested in movies and TV. So we got to thinking about it and decided, why not both? Our main channel will still bring you all the biggest news, reviews, previews, and trailers to keep you up to speed on the most important highlights. But if you only want games content 24/7, head over to IGN Games. Movies and TV more your thing? Check out IGN Movies and TV. More channels, more of the stuff you love, more IGN.
Welcome back to GameScoop Live. I'm Damon Hatfield, and with me are Miranda Sanchez, Lucy O'Brien, and Zach Ryan. Right now we are talking PlayStation. In the midst of all of these E3 announcements, PlayStation has been pretty quiet. Ratchet & Clank, Rift Apart has been very well received, but we don't really know what to expect for the rest of the year and beyond. Horizon Forbidden West will hopefully be out sometime this year, and the God of War sequel got pushed to 2022. Lucy, Philip, what do you think? What is next for PlayStation and the PS5?
Well, I think we need a state of play. You know, like if Sony is going to skip out on E3 and only show off Horizon Forbidden West prior to that, really, as the big kind of focus, I do think we need a more well-rounded state of play to just remind PlayStation owners that there's stuff coming for them. And, you know, we've certainly heard that there's stuff being made that hasn't been announced. So it would be very cool to just have a little bit more communication from Sony coming up in the next month or so. With all that said, I mean, I am so excited for, like, look at this footage, Horizon Forbidden West. I am so excited. Do I believe it's going to come out this year? No, if I'm being completely honest. You know, if I was a betting woman, which I'm not, thankfully, you know, I would bet that this is going to be delayed. I think that I know it's been worked on for several years, but it's so huge in scope, and the communication around what they're aiming for in terms of release date has been very sort of loosey-goosey flexible. So I don't think we'll see it until next year. God of War, you know, obviously has been pushed. I'm totally fine with both of these games being delayed. With that said, I do think that if we're not seeing these big heavy hitter sequels coming out this year, then again, that's why we need more info as to what you know, we have to look forward to. I mean, Ratchet & Clank Rift Apart, I'm playing it right now. I'm having such a blast with it. It is just such a showcase of what the PlayStation 5 can do. And I just want, you know, I want to keep riding that hype train. I want some more stuff coming out for the PS5. I want more PS5s to be out there in the wild for people who want one. You know, I think that there is some work for Sony to do here. And I have all the faith in the world that we'll see some good stuff soon.
I know you said you're not a betting woman, but if you were, would you bet there is a state of play coming soon?
I would say yes. I have no insider info, but I think from a consumer-friendly, consumer-forward standpoint, I would say that is definitely a smart move, and I'm fairly certain one will be coming soon.
Mm-hmm. Of course, Ratchet & Clank Rift Apart, big showcase for the PS5, almost universal acclaim from critics. I finished it a couple nights ago. I think we're all playing it. I believe, Miranda, you just started it last night. Is that right?
Yeah, just started last night, got it downloaded, and I was like, oh, I played through there, but I went a different way. That's okay.
Yeah, this is one of the early areas in the game. So what were your first impressions?
It feels like I'm playing a Saturday morning cartoon that I just started randomly, because like, I haven't played any Ratchet and Clank games before. My brother used to be really into them, so I have some familiarity with them. And it's just very old school in design, and like how I think there's just a lot of boxes you destroy, then stuff goes everywhere that it just collects, and yeah, then you just hit some enemies. Like it's very straightforward. Like there's not a lot there as far as where I'm at. Like that's complex, and like there's not a lot to do, and that's kind of a thing that bummed me out, because it's like, oh, this looks like the first next gen game, and like I'm in this city area and it's kind of just a lot of repeating things, like just the same robots over and over, and like kind of just the same screens, and like there's this one stall you can interact with, but everything else is like, oh, there's definitely a lot going on here, huh? So I kind of wish there was a little bit more to do, but I know it's not supposed to be like this big open world where you're supposed to find everything. Even though I think finding stuff is fun to an extent. There's like those, oh, you don't have an upgrade to come up here yet. And I am a little irritated with him keep yelling at me saying I have to go to the nightclub. And I'm like, Ratchet, I do not want to go to the nightclub yet. I want to go get you some upgrades. So, yeah. But those little complaints aside, like I am having a fun time with it. I like the little fun guy. He's just like this little mushroom dude who shoots stuff, and he helps me in battle. I like that. So I'm interested in that. I'll definitely keep with it. It's a pretty game for sure, and it's nice to have like that graphical showcase, right? Like I think we've been sort of waiting for those games to come out. Like with Halo, we're just like, hey guys, Master Chief is not launching with ray tracing. What? Does he not deserve ray tracing? And so it's like, you of course they delayed the game. And this is kind of, I felt like my first foray into a big next gen sort of showcase for those graphics and like the ray tracing and just pretty particles. And that's what I've been enjoying a lot in this so far.
Yeah, it is nice to have a graphical showcase that's a PS5 exclusive. But of course, both Horizon Forbidden West and God of War are going to be cross-gen games, both PS4 and PS5. Whereas coming out of the Microsoft showcase, they revealed a lot of games that are just Series X exclusive, like Starfield and Redfall. So, Lucy, does that concern you? Do you worry about the PlayStation 5 sort of being able to keep up with these games that are going to be Series X exclusives?
I mean, I understand the argument on both sides. I understand that people are disappointed, you know, based on a theory that there might be cut corners, right? And sort of essentially downgrading these PS5 experiences. But I'm not worried. I don't think, you know, we're looking at this footage from Horizon Forbidden West. I don't think this looks downgraded at all. I think it looks absolutely beautiful. And I think that the proof is in the footage, right? Like if it looked like a last gen game, if it looked, you know, like it was playing on a PlayStation 4, yeah, I'd be asking questions. But look at look at this. This is a PS5 game. And I don't think that Sony is in any hurry to downplay exactly what the PS5 is capable of. I don't think that Horizon Forbidden West is going to be anything less than a graphical showcase. And I'm pleased, ultimately, that PS4 owners, of which there are so many, there is such a huge user base there, are going to be able to play these games as well, especially while the PS5 is still in such scarce supply, and God knows how long that's going to last. You know, that's my personal opinion. I can see it from the other side as well, but I personally think that it's a good thing. Right now, it's a good thing. You know, if the sort of vague cross-generation continues, then I'll be asking questions. But right now, I think that it's a smart move.
Mm-hmm. Now, Zach, Horizon Zero Dawn and Breath of the Wild are often compared to each other, perhaps unfairly, but they came out so close to one another in both open world games. So we know you're very excited for Breath of the Wild 2. How would you sort of rate your excitement for Forbidden West?
Yeah, we were talking about this a little bit before the show. Not a huge Horizon fan. Didn't really do it for me. This game certainly looks absolutely gorgeous, and I will play it because I'm interested in seeing what any Sony first-party studio has to offer. Also, I think, you know, like my impression of the first game was, it's a kind of a tired comparison, but I think it definitely could benefit from sort of the Assassin's Creed to Assassin's Creed 2 kind of jump, where the first game was fine, and I think the second game could be something really magical. So I would say I'm medium hyped for this game.
Yeah, I agree that it's what we're seeing certainly looks beautiful. I hope this one feels a little bit less restrictive in your exploration. That was one of my criticisms of the first game. But thinking about God of War, we don't really know much of anything about, we haven't, you know, what that game is. We haven't even seen any sort of gameplay footage. So Lucy, what are sort of your hopes and dreams for what the God of War sequel is when it arrives next year?
Oh God. Well, I thought that was it 2019 that the God of War came out, or was it 2018? 2018. I thought that game was close to perfect. For me, I'm just more interested in the story side of things. Like there's not a huge amount I would suggest in terms of gameplay changes. I thought that game felt so good to play. God, it was like a drug playing that thing. I am so invested in this story, and I know that Santa Monica is, they're very, very talented storytellers. So I just want to see another game that touches, those sorts of unexpected emotional highs of the 2018 game. And I'm really, really excited to see more. We've got nothing but this logo, which I feel I've seen so much. I'm like dreaming of it now. For my money, it's all about the story and delving deeper into these characters. Mm-hmm.
I'm super excited for the sequel, whatever it turns up being. God of War was my favorite game of 2018. It was also a year that it had to compete with Red Dead Redemption 2. Mm-hmm. There are a couple other big announcements over Summer of Gaming and E3 that we could hit on before we run out of time. Ubisoft's one more thing from its conference was Avatar, which was a little surprising to me, although what we saw looked very, very pretty. I guess as we were talking yesterday, maybe there are more Avatar fans out there than I'm aware of.
It has to be.
I think that would certainly be the case, yeah, considering, yeah, its placement on the worldwide box office, Damon.
Well, yeah. I know that it was brought back into theaters, and yeah.
Yeah. But isn't it like we all win because it's like, this is the 3D experience of a lifetime? We're like, it's all right, I'll buy it. I'll go see what this is about. And then we're like, oh, okay. I mean, that's how I felt anyway. I was like, that was a really long movie. And it was kind of like Pocahontas. I've heard comparisons to Fern Gully. It's like, I've seen this story before. It's just really blue.
I think that Massive is a tremendously talented developer.
That's true.
I think that they've done some really interesting things with, like The Division and The Division 2, and that DLC was really impressive. Clearly, there's been some work being done on this game for a long time. Like, we knew that this game was in development at least they confirmed last fall. I thought it was really awesome to see this, and we've gotten more words since this trailer dropped that it is going to be like a first-person open-world adventure, which is exciting. I'm not a huge Avatar fan myself, but this game does look like it's doing some interesting stuff, and I think, honestly, like taking a sort of Far Cry example and putting that in kind of a foreign alien world and letting you do a bunch of weird stuff with weird critters, I think could be really cool. I'm also really excited for Massive to take on the Star Wars mantle. Mm-hmm. We knew that they're developing something there, and that their work on the Avatar game helped them secure whatever they're going to do with Star Wars. So whatever Disney saw in them based on this game is obviously pretty promising.
I was just going to say, Zach, I think it's going to be a game as a service for sure. Mm-hmm.
Wars or this one?
This one, Avatar.
Okay.
I think what's going to happen is they're going to time it just before, the first movie drops. And as the subsequent movies, I've completely forgotten how many there are because
there have been so many
announced. As every movie drops, there'll be more added to the game, and it will be an ongoing game. That is my belief in this game anyway, that it is definitely going to be a game as a service. See, which is Ubisoft's MO right now.
It's true.
I they did say that they were leaning more into games of service last year. I don't know, I disagree. I think that Star Wars will be Massive's games of service game. I think that we'll probably see that as a more expansive ongoing game, and this might be a standalone thing, because honestly they could probably cash in a few times as these movies drop. We know that this game takes place on the other side of Pandora and is focused on a different set of characters from the film. So I think that they could come back to this pool a couple of times throughout the course of the next however many decades it takes for these movies to drop. So
let's make a bet.
Okay. But you just said you were not a betting woman in the previous segment. So
I've changed my mind in the course of this podcast.
Rules. Yeah.
The Game Scoop has led Lucy to gambling.
That's right.
Speaking of
drugs.
Yes, that's right. And drugs, a lot of vices. Speaking of Alien Worlds, one of the pleasant surprises of E3 for me was Guardians of the Galaxy. from Square Enix and Eidos Montreal. I think this game looks really cool. Pleasantly surprised, and that's someone that's coming from someone who's a little bit disappointed with Marvel's Avengers, but I like that they're just sticking to single player game, playing as one character, although I also understand there's disappointment that people can't, you know, choose characters since the Guardians are a very diverse group of superheroes. But I think they kind of get the characters for the most part. I think the jokes were landing for the most part. I like the alien design, the creatures, and these interesting worlds that we're going to be visiting. Miranda, did this one do anything for you?
Guardians is definitely one of my, I guess, higher tier Marvel franchises. My big problem with this was Star-Lord's hair.
Well,
this
yeah.
guy is from the yeah. 80s. This yeah. guy loves the 80s. That hair's not 80s, man. That is not 80s. But we got Groot. So I don't care. I'm happy. I just love Groot. Yeah. I don't know. I like this team a lot. They're very quirky. And Damon, as you said, like, they did a good job on selling the humor. I think that's just such an important part of Guardians. And if you don't get that right, then it's not Guardians. So
yeah.
I think it looks neat.
I got heavy Mass Effect vibes, you know, mm-hmm. like obviously your choices are going to carry over. Heavy Telltale vibes, you know, we saw that sequence of Rocket Raccoon being thrown across the chasm, and then it said Rocket is like very angry about this, which I think, you know, I think that's really interesting. And I can't discount Eidos Montreal as a developer. Both of those Deus Ex games were phenomenal. I'm really excited to see what they do with the Guardians. This game to me looks solid. I'm not like...
Yeah.
like over the roof, over the moon hyped for it, but it's definitely something that I want to check out because, like Miranda, Guardians is one of my favorite Marvel things ever. So
yeah, well, it's coming in October, and there's actually going to be a lot to play in October, so I don't know if I'll get to it day one, because October has Metroid Dread, Far Cry 6, Back for Blood, but I'm excited for Guardians. Lucy, did the reveal do anything for you?
Yeah, I mean, for me, it was all about the writing. The game itself looks like perfectly fine, but the writing was so exceptional in this trailer. The narrative designer, lead narrative designer in this game is Mary DeMarle, who also wrote Deus Ex Human Revolution. And I think that everything we saw in this trailer was just pitch perfect in terms of the characters that, you know, we've grown to love over the course of the MCU, and you know, sort of character models notwithstanding. But yeah, the jokes, I found this trailer funny. Like, I sort of had a little bit of a genuine laugh out loud moment a couple of times.
Did you do a little chuckle?
That little chuckle, chuckle. It was great. The tone was absolutely perfect. And for me, that's what Guardians of the Galaxy is all about, is getting those characters right. If you get them even a little bit off, it's like, it's cringy, right? And for me, this was just all bang on. So I'm very excited for this game for that reason.
Mm-hmm. Well, my friends, that is all the time we have today. But thanks to my guests. Thanks to everyone who tuned in at home to watch us live. IGN's Summer of Gaming continues with our Pride stream on Friday, the EA Play event on July 22nd. Hopefully it'll be some dead space there. And Gamescom on deck for August. You can catch all of our coverage on those events and everything that pops up in between over at IGN.com, on YouTube, across social media, or even on your smart TV. Check IGN for a full schedule. Thanks again. My name's Damon Hatfield. GameScoop is out. So long, everybody. Until next time.
IGN Summer of Gaming 2021 is presented by USAA Insurance and Army National Guard. Pursue multiple paths while you serve. Reach your greatest potential with Army National Guard. And by the Amazon original movie, The Tomorrow War, exclusively on Prime Video July 2nd. And powered by Duracell Optimum, the official battery sponsor of Summer of Gaming 2021.
If you're not following IGN on social media, what are you waiting for? We're constantly updating our feeds to bring you the latest news, gameplay, custom original content, the best user-generated videos and art, memes, and a whole lot more. Be part of the conversation throughout the year. Follow IGN on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, TikTok, and Snapchat.
a world with nonstop news about Marvel, DC, Star Wars, you need a show with accurate reporting, hard-hitting commentary, and...
Me, Akeem Lewanson, host of IGN's news show, The Fix Entertainment. Whether it's the latest superhero scoop, film fiasco, or anime announcement, I'll be here covering all the breaking movie, TV, and streaming news that matters most to you. Make sure to catch The Fix Entertainment on IGN for your fix of entertainment news. Let's drop it.
Competition brings out the best in all of us. Well, mostly.
Oh, that's a controller break.
That's unfortunate.
Welcome to IGN Compete, where we bring you the stories behind the esports headlines.
Reigning world champions!
From the triumphs...
Daryl takes the game!
...to the hardships...
It's not heavy!
...to the miracle moments that will go down in history.
Man, I just can't believe it!
It's crazy.
It's all here on IGN Compete.
God, I'm in disbelief!